thank Mark and Joanne Skousen for the privilege of speaking at Freedom Fest. This is a remarkable conference and one that I really look forward to speaking at every year. It hasn't been that many years, but they have been proud years. And when they asked me to speak this year, I immediately said yes, looking forward to this opportunity. I didn't know whether I would be able to do it because I'm kind of marching my last days. But we worked it out where, with the help of my daughter Keely and her operation, we would be able to make this event. I would be able to give the speech, hopefully with alacrity and capability, and do it in such a way as that it would make it something that I'm proud to be a part of. This will be 40 years of giving speeches on this subject being first principles, the things that make what we stand for all valuable and all important. I started giving speeches on first principles back in the 1960s. And I'm really proud to have been able to do it with some air of capability. So thank you, Mark and Joanne, for this capability and opportunity that makes it all worthwhile. I want to tell you what the first principles mean to me and what they should mean to you and all of us. We build our lives around capabilities and ideas that means something to all of us and our families. And I know it's truthful for all of the people at this conference, or at least those who make up this conference. The first principles that make up our lives are God, family, country, property. Those are the things that make it all worthwhile. I remember back in the early 60s, when I was just a young man, I was looking to find those values that would be of value to me and my family. And the things that first made it so were what I found going on clear over in a woebegone area of South Africa called the Katanga Province. There in the Katanga Province, a young Christian by the name of Moise Tshombe was doing the best he could to provide leadership for his people in a way that would allow them to build lives of value, only to find that everything they tried to do, everything they intended to do, was being undermined by the forces of the United Nations organization. And they were doing it in a brutal way. They were attacking, and it was genocide. And it was all to the benefit of a young communist revolutionary by the name of Patrice Lumumba. Lumumba was using everything he could to dispose Tshombe and his people and take control of the rich copper provinces so that he could go ahead and wage a civil war against his own people and use that money to build this conference and this Congolese capability into a nightmare that would allow him to virtually destroy those people that were working so hard to find a new life and new capability. That was so shocking to me that it was a real eye-opener. It allowed me to start looking at other things and say, wow, what's happening here? But why would the United States and the Western countries like Belgium, for example, allow this capability to go unchallenged? Well, that served as a real eye-opener. And it served as a way to start taking a look at other things that were vicious in their ramifications. Then from there, we looked on, and we looked at other capabilities that were being unleashed that were not good, not capable, and certainly not in the defense of freedom. So here we are 40 years later. And I've been looking and continuing to look, and I'm very proud of what we've been able to do we've been able to write books, we've been able to do things in the area of launching newsletters and launching efforts that have been so valuable, that have helped our colleagues in so many ways, of which we are very proud. Now, as we look down through the vast panoply of effort, you come to find out that there's another whole area that is so vitally important to what we're trying to do and the lessons we're trying to leave to friends and fellow freedom fighters around the world. That's vital and almost unbelievable. Who would have thought 40 years ago that while we were fighting for the freedom effort in the area of the Congo, that 40 years later we would find ourselves involved in a battle that would not only serve to help the people in South Africa, but also the people in places like China. I could never have believed that back in the 1960s, fighting for the vision of freedom in China would be an integral part of what we're doing here. As I travel to China today, now I find that the Chinese people are in the forefront of this battle for freedom of ideas. And that's the part that is really intriguing. We find that we are in the battle for the freedom of ideas. And that has always been the case. We've always been in the battle for the freedom of ideas. And this battle for the freedom of ideas is at the core of what we're doing. And it will be at the core of what we're going to be doing for as far into the future as we can see. Many people, for generations, thought that really Mao Zedong was right, that power grew out of the barrel of a gun. He was wrong. He was wrong on so many things. There is no power coming out of the barrel of guns today. The power is coming out of the ideas. And that's why conferences like this are so vitally important. What do? They sponsor and promote ideas. Ideas of this type that are being washed and burnished and cleaned up and sent around the world. It's amazing to see how many people that came out of the universities at the time I did were regulated almost into not believing anything because it was considered by the professors as beneath investigation. That ideas like intelligent design were not only not worthy of investigation, they were beneath anything of that sort. They were held up to contempt. Now, those of you who don't know what we're talking about here are missing the flight of a lifetime. The whole idea that people could believe in something other than Darwinian evolution is considered beneath contempt and almost a whole idea that doesn't deserve anything other than a complete disregard. We can do the same thing with so many other ideas. Our young stepson, who's going to the University of Chicago, Nick, is amazed at what he finds out as he goes through his undergraduate studies as to what is held up as worthy of examination. If he studies anything, he's going to find that a zero-sum game is only understood by those who believe in socialism, and as he studies and takes a look at the world around him, he's finding out that such is not the case. A zero-sum game does not attribute anything to the better glory of mankind. It just leaves out the idea that one man's gain can be another man's gain, and that these capabilities are being held out on a daily basis. Let one man's gain be another man's gain. Let the rising tide lift all ships. Let the economic battery of capability provide capability for everyone. That's the part that is so exciting. And that's the part that makes our lives and these principles that we believe in so important. And what we are finding is that if you present these ideas as are being done here at this conference, not only are these ideas accepted, they are found to be intriguing, and that brings these students together, makes them of a like mind. When I was preparing my thoughts for this presentation, I started to give ideas, try to give design to where would we go from here? Where are the battles going to be fought? Where are the people going to be carrying on their arguments and their onslaughts? And I guess it's pretty simple, really, as I look at it. Right now, as I look forward to the next 40 years, I think the battles are going to be fought in the classrooms and in the front rooms. They're going to be looking at Americans to carry on fights in ways that we could never have anticipated before. The cultural war, as I guess it's being called, are the ideas that are going to be engaged. When I take a look at it, I see it in wrapped up in the Marxist ideas of Antonio Gramsci, the Italian Marxist who came to the fight and says, okay, let's admit it, fellow Marxists, we lost the war as it relates to economics. We lost the war as it relates to battlegrounds. Gramsci, when he was a young communist in Italy back in the 20s, come to realize that this was beyond their capability. They were not capable. And so they come to realize that if they're going to win, they're going to win by tearing away at the very core ideas that make up Western civilization. Gramsci believed that you win this war by tearing out the heart and soul, by destroying the very core of Western cultural ideas. It's a frightening concept, because cultural ideas are brought up and nurtured over a long period of time. And if you destroy cultural ideas, you end up destroying what makes for the very heart of a culture. And it starts with family ideas. Looking back over these years and what they represent, we have to really come to grips with what makes it of value. What is a first principle? A first principle is something that you're willing to fight for. It's something you're willing to die for. I'm proud of the fact that my grandson, Benjamin, is in his Marine unit. He's fighting. He's not dying, hopefully. But he's fighting in such a way as to be a guardian for first principles. He's willing to do it, and I am willing to support him for it in every step of the way. And such is the way with regard to engaging. How do you win the war? You win not necessarily with the battle of guns and bullets. You win it with ideas. You win it with ideas. And that's why I applaud Mark and Joanne for Freedom Fest. The ability to fight the war in ways that promote the ideas. The ideas are really what's critical. So, probably looking at the realities of my health problems, I won't make it back next year. But that's okay. I won't be resting with the guns and bullets, but I will be arguing with what is at core here. What is what's key? How will I be able to have done it? Well, I will have been able to do it the way we're doing it now, sharing ideas in ways that make this a very powerful conduit. What I would like to do now is have our ideas moved around and examined. I'll be sitting by the telephone, awaiting telephone calls too. So, if you will allow me to stop the monologue, I will stop the monologue and we will go forward by taking questions from the audience. Again, thank you, Mark and Joanne, for inviting me. If there are any questions, I'd be delighted to take them.